morning. Welcome to Compass Christian Church on this glorious Sunday morning. In traditional southwestern Cincinnati fashion, we are going straight from winter to summer. But let's enjoy it this weekend. We're so glad that you're here with us today and those on Zoom joining us. It's so nice that we can gather in any way that we can. If you would please join us in our opening hymn, Thine is the Glory. Responsive call to worship. Happy Easter season. Today is the first day of the week.
The joy of Easter still sings in our hearts.
Breathe the breath of new life in your spirits.
We open our hearts to all the wondrous work God has for us to do.
Welcome to worship this glorious day.
Let our lives be testimony to God's redeeming love.
Please join me in our opening prayer.
Breathe the breath of new life into us, O Lord, that we may fully feel the power of your love and the awesome glory of the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Prepare us to receive your blessing and then to go from this place to be a blessing to others in your name. Amen.
You may be seated. I don't see any little ones this morning, so we are going to go ahead with our prayer joys and concerns. I do have several to share with you this morning. So as we begin our prayer time together, let's sing and get our hearts in the right place by singing, Spirit of God, descend upon my heart.
Stooped
you're wondering why Lacey and her beautiful voice is not up here singing, she has laryngitis. Not that the weather in Southwest Ohio and the allergies have anything to mess with our sinuses, but she is sitting back and being a well-deserved pew person today. So let's begin. In a moment of silent prayer, lifting before God our own joys and concerns, and laying at God's feet our own sins and repentances. After a moment, I will lead us in a pastoral prayer, followed by all of us saying the Lord's Prayer. I do invite you to share that prayer using any words or language that you feel comfortable praying today, for that is your part of our prayer together. Let us pray. Gracious God, power of life, we praise you that you have not abandoned us to the living death of sin and despair, but that with Jesus Christ you have lifted us up from the grave. Grant that we might ourselves know the power of the resurrection now and in the world to come. And gracious God, Lord of life, hear us as we lift to you our hopes and prayers for the church and all the world. Let your grace empower us as people of faith to better serve you in the commonplaces of our lives and in the people we meet on our faith journeys. Open our eyes to the living Christ as we pray for and work with the poor, the brokenhearted, the sick, and the bereaved. Hear our prayers for those who are close to our hearts, some that have been named aloud, and others who remain hidden in our minds. In your resurrecting power, lift them up and give them renewed strength and hope, and give to us all new faith by which to live our days with you. Then will our lives be living witnesses to your resurrection, made whole by your love and care. In Christ's spirit, we pray as he taught us to, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our Bible reading this morning is from John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. Listen for God's word. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord Jesus, and he said to them again, Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I sent you. When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, We have seen the Lord. But he said to them, Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails In the mark of the nails in my hand, in his side, I will not believe. A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. May his word enrich our lives.
Would you pray with me? And now, O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Last Sunday, the celebration of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, we proclaimed with joy and wonder, "He is risen. He is risen indeed." That was the theme for the day. That was the truth renewed and declared. The stone was rolled away. The Lord is alive. And what we have is an empty tomb. The women came to the tomb with the spices they had prepared for the body. Seeing heavenly messengers, they believed and ran to tell the men. But when the women told their news to the male disciples, what they had seen and learned at the tomb, that empty tomb, the men didn't even believe them. These words seemed to them an idle tale, says one gospel. And so when we read the story of what happened next, when Jesus came into the house and stood among his disciples, we have to wonder what was going through their minds. After all, these were the same disciples who had refused to believe the women until they could see it with their own eyes. And even running to the tomb itself to see what he could find, Peter did not go in. He stayed outside, only seeing the emptiness. And then, as we read in the Gospel of John today, when it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. They got it. Finally, they believed. But not all. No. Just as there were disbelievers at the tomb, there is a disbeliever in their midst in today's story. Thomas, of course. No sooner does one believe than another does not. And these back and forth tales of belief and disbelief persist throughout all of Christian history. But Thomas, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." Thomas was the holdout. There is no record of the other disciples' response to this, but they could hardly claim the moral ground, because looking back in John's story only a few sentences before, we read that Jesus showed them his hands and his side. And it was only then that the disciples rejoiced at seeing the Lord. What is it about proof? Why do these disciples, the ones who were closest to Jesus, who walked with him, ate at table with him, listened to the wisdom of his preaching, why do they require something more in order to believe? And how much is enough to tip the scale? Tip the scale. That's the image I want to keep in mind as we think about this today. Have you ever watched one of those dog shows on TV where the dog has to do tricks and trials and they're judged? Sometimes the dogs have to run an obstacle course. And one of the obstacles will be a teeter-totter of some sort, where the dog has to run up one side and carefully balance itself for a moment before stepping to the other side of the teeter-totter. Kurt is shaking his head. He's watched that before. At this point, the dogs, once they hit that other side, they no longer walk. They just run. Once they hit that balancing point, they jump off that teeter-totter in their excitement. Faith, my friends, is much like that teeter-totter. It's a balancing act of running up one side of consideration to the tipping point and having reached that dangerous ground, that area where we can safely balance on a comfortable side or stand in the middle, and then running off and jumping off when we get to the other side. This is a useful application of the expression leap of faith, is it not? Because that's exactly what it is. Most often, what we find when we get to that fulcrum, that tipping point of faith, is only spiritual thin air on the other side. It's much safer, we think, to stay on the uphill side where we can have solid wood under our feet. It's more uncertain, scarier even, to have to scramble to keep our footing and balance just like those dogs on the obstacle course before we decide to jump. The threshold of the empty tomb of Easter morning is a fulcrum. It's a tipping point, a place of decision. Imagine two people on a teeter-totter facing each other. What is in between them, in the middle, is the threshold of that tomb, that door with the stone pushed away. Is that door an entry or an exit? What does each person on the teeter-totter see? Do they see a way in or a way out? In his collection of essays called A Grief Observed, C.S. Lewis writes this: "You never know how much you really believe anything until its truth or falsehood becomes a matter of life or death. It is easy to say you believe a rope to be strong and sound as long as you are merely using it to wrap a box. But suppose you had to hang by that rope over a precipice, wouldn't you then first discover how much you really trusted it? Such is faith. What is necessary for us to believe? We can all practice religion, That's what we're doing here and now, enacting out worship and remembering Christ in the Lord's Supper together. That is the stuff of identifying ourselves as disciples or Methodists or Baptists or any of the thousands of other Christian labels and distinctions. All of us who call ourselves Christian are not necessarily converted to faith. Tongue in cheek, we might claim that there is complete agreement in the church and every other church about whether to have wine or grape juice for communion, whether to have candles on the altar, or whether to have no altar at all. But those are the things and stuff of religion. And yet, so often, these are the things that divide us, that get in the way of Christian believing and true Christian community. But Jesus was not concerned so much with matters of religion as he was with matters of faith. Think back on the stories of Jesus, his ministry, his interactions with people. Do you remember the stories of the Pharisees criticizing Jesus for eating food that was unwashed, for healing on the Sabbath, for sharing a meal and associating with those who were considered less desirable people of society? And what was Jesus' response in every single case? Those are trappings. Those are not the things that are important. Those are not the things of the kingdom of God. In the season of Easter, we tell stories not of religion, but of faith and of believing, of standing at the entrance to the tomb and deciding whether or not to go in, of being closed in the house with the disciples and greeting our Lord, of the women, the only ones who believed without question or denial, of Peter and the other disciples, of Thomas, because he demanded to see and touch. May each of us this Easter season come to know the risen Christ in a new way. May the event of Easter be a unifying experience to bring together the body of Christ instead of breaking it again and again on a cross. May we celebrate our differences that will be honored as we gather at Pentecost and celebrate the sanctification of the Holy Spirit at the end of this Easter season. May we remember that it is Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ only who unites us, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, so that we cling to our faith more firmly than we do our religion. And when we do that, we can all say together, Amen. Each week in the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, we give you an opportunity to accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. If you've never made that decision before, I invite you to do so today. As we sing a hymn together, I'll meet you down front, and I'll share with you a confession of faith that we find in Scripture. And we will look forward to your baptism in the near future. If you are on Zoom, I can reach out to you there as well. But maybe today you've made that decision at one time or something similar to it. But today, on this second Sunday of Easter, you'd like to reaffirm and rededicate your life to Christ. We do that the same way. Or maybe today, you would like to make Compass Christian Church your church home. Let's make any or all of these decisions as we sing together, Now the Green Blade Rises. Before our invitation to communion, I will remind you that we are doing communion a little different these days. You're invited to stay seated, and a deacon will serve you your communion. There is two cups. The bread is on the bottom. The juice is on the top. I invite you to go ahead and eat the bread as it is passed to you. Hold on to that cup, and we will share the cup together. Luke wrote of our risen Savior, who at the table with two of the disciples took bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. Their eyes were opened, and they recognized the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread. In company with all believers in every time and place and beyond all time and place, we come to this table to know the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread. For Scripture tells us that on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, after the meal, he took a cup, and when he blessed it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "This is the new covenant in my blood poured out for you. Drink this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim my death and resurrection until I come again." Let us pray.
Amazing, transformative God, we do give you so much thanks and praise this morning for these elements representing your gift to us. Thank you so much, God, for the gift of nourishment and refreshment that we are so privileged to take part in, and then help us to be that for those we are in contact with this week. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
I did forget to tell you that all of our communion is gluten-free. These are the gifts of God for the people of God, my friends. Thanks be to God. It has been good to be in the house. Oh, not yet. Sorry.
Now is our chance to respond to these wonderful gifts. And at this time, we'll take up our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
give you thanks for these gifts that we're returning to you, and ask God that they are used to your glory. We know that you will do far more than we can ever ask or imagine. Amen.
Now, it has been good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. I have a plethora of announcements, of church life events to share with us all. First, today, right after worship, though they're getting the band back together, as Ed's been saying, if you are interested in singing in choir again, stay for a few moments. We've got a lot of ideas floating around that we need to kind of just talk and see where everyone's at. So stay for a few moments. Quiam's going to stay with us as well for a few minutes, and we'll have that meeting. Also today, many people have said, how can we help Anna? How can we help Ukraine? Well, today is a day that you can do it. From 12 to 6, yes, that's not a typo. The time has been extended because they're thinking this is going to be such a huge, wonderful, successful event. There is a Ukrainian food festival out on Fleming Road, just west of Wyoming. Fleming Road kind of connects Route 4 and Winton. If you want to support the efforts in Ukraine, you can go. Admission is free, but there'll be things to purchase. There'll be raffles. It's a festival. Today is the Ukrainian Orthodox Church's Easter. So all kinds of wonderful dishes, food to share. And Anna has asked that we share this. Lots of you have asked to help. I've seen it on just about every news channel. And so it is going to be big and fun. So hopefully some of you all can be there. Tuesday night, we have our Vacation Bible School meeting. This did not make it into the Wednesday announcements. I do apologize for that. But if you can be here Tuesday night at 7, if you can't be here, talk to Carol Yarborough in the back. She's also sent out emails. If you didn't get an email regarding Bible school, let her know, because she'll put you on the list. And we need to get that up and running, my friends. And it'll be here Saturday, X Days. We are going to Dayton, y'all, and we are going to help, continue to help fix up houses and build houses for those that are still impacted by the tornadoes of 2 years ago. We'll be working with Week of Compassion. We have some people coming from Carthage Christian Church to work with us. It's a wonderful effort. We do have some paperwork that you have to fill out. You have to be fully vaccinated. So see Dave Deal if you need that paperwork. If you can come for a couple of hours on Saturday and none on Sunday, or a couple hours on Sunday and none on Saturday, it's all good. More hands, light work. All hands on deck. Please support X Days. There will not be worship next Sunday in the building. We will have a worship service of some kind at the job site with our new friends that we will be making as we work alongside of folks. So no worship in the building next Sunday. And it is time to buy a blanket for your mama. No, this is not the blanket your mama gets. This is the blankets that Church World Service uses after natural disasters like tornadoes, after fires. This is the blanket that people can either use as a tent to keep them out of the elements. They can sleep on it as a pallet on the ground. They can sleep under it to keep warm. And so if you would like and would help out Church World Service by purchasing a blanket in honor or in memory of your mama, we would love that. And the order forms are on the welcome table. And if you're on Zoom and y'all would like to order a blanket, just contact Debbie at the church office and she'll get that taken care of for us. And Laura has an announcement. Turn her table mic on, friends.
So I'm very blessed to be a little part of a really cool program here in Cincinnati. It's called Step Forward, and it's running with people in recovery to do the flying pig. So this is through City Gospel Mission, and so on Saturday mornings, my dog, my new dog Chance, and I have been going down to run with folks that live in the houses that are in a very difficult time in their journey of life, in recovery from substance abuse. And most of them, if they've done any exercise, it's not been in quite a long time. And so I want to just share a brief story about one man in particular that's really totally touched my heart and all of us, is that he was 2 years ago living in a tent, and he was an alcoholic, and in his words, he did not want to give up his alcohol. And people tried to reach out to him, and he would say no. And then some church folks, I guess, persisted, and he did kind of make a turn and allow them to help him a little bit. And then he made the huge, life-changing, difficult decision and difficult thing to do to go into the Step Forward house there at City Gospel Mission. Unfortunately, he got bit by a spider before he got out of that tent. And so he has had three toes amputated. Last year, he walked the 5K. And this year, he's going for the 10K. So this guy is amazing. But most of us, or most of them, will be doing the 5K. We've got a couple people that will be doing the half marathon on Sunday. So anyway, I'm pledged to give $2,000 to them. If you want to support this program, just let me know. You can do it via cash. Even $5 or $10 helps. A check, or like there's an electronic link and all that kind of stuff too. So,
and we can get that in the weekly email if you send me that link.
Yes,
we will put it in the weekly email.
Thank you.
Thanks, Laura. Are there other church life events that we need to share? Then let's stand together for our closing song and our blessing. Resurrects, God renews. God is love, and love never ends. So go with hope, go with peace, go with joy, and know that God's love endures forever. Amen.